from Russia with love, I fly to you, much wiser since my goodbye to you.
I've traveled. Hello, Michael from Red Chair Diaries, coming to you from my disheveled living room, Nova Scotia, Canada. It's February 5th, 2015. We discuss From Russia with Love, book into film. It's the paperback. I bought it at a used bookstore a few months ago, but then I got it on ebooks for 99 cents, so I actually read the ebook. This is from the 60s, I believe, the American cover. And the book was published in 1957. So there we go. Now, this is the second movie. It's like the sixth or seventh book. This is probably the one that is closest to the source material. I just finished the book yesterday, watched half the movie yesterday, watched the other half just a minute ago. And I've seen it several times. It's very, very close to the book. I mean, the producers, screenwriters, directors, whatever, moved a few scenes around, put a chase on a boat at the end that was not in the book. But, and it also had an intro before the titles where you think Bond is getting it, but it's actually a double with a mask or something at the Spectre's headquarters or assassination school or whatever they go to. But for the most part, it's as written. And what they moved around, what was interesting is the first part of this book spends a few chapters explaining the Grant character, who also masquerades as Mr. Nash in this. And this is very interesting psychologically, discussing the fact that he was completely amoral, probably asexual, and just was a very large baby, I think with an English father or an English mother and a foreign father. And he just liked to kill things. And whenever there was a full moon, just like vampires, he seemed to have the urge to kill. So they went into the background. I mean, Ian Fleming wrote a very, very interesting background for him. So that's how the book begins, explaining about the Grant character and his decision to defect to become a murderer for Russia. Then they also have an interesting part where they discuss different levels of status for members of the Soviet Union, the army, or whatever. And the girl from Russia with Love, Tatiana Romanov, called Tanya most of the time, she was a low-level corporal. They explained that she was living in an apartment building in Moscow that was built by prison labor. She was on the third floor and had one room and had to share a bathroom, and she thought she was doing quite well. And then Rosa Klebb, who is the villain of the piece, the ugly woman with the poison points hidden in her shoes, a master assassin and planning assassinations. She was on the eighth floor and had a nicer suite. So that was interesting how Ian Fleming was discussing the status over there, which I believe is quite true, or was quite true in the 1957 when this was published. Whereas in the book, they don't go into all of that, or in the movie, they don't go into all of that. And she ends up getting her assignment from Rosa Klebb, comrade general, I think it was, or comrade colonel Klebb, in Istanbul. So she seems to be stationed in Istanbul in the movie, in Turkey. Now, the plot is very, very simple, as most of the novels have very simple plots. It's the movies that go way off on different tangents. And in the book, James Bond has been an embarrassment to Smersh, which is the basically the assassination bureau of Russia, and derailed Dr. No is alluded to. That was the first movie, but not the first book. But derailed him, derailed Casino Royale. The chef was, his death was lamented by Smirsch in the book, and so on. So somebody comes up with a plan that they'll plant her as somebody who was a low-level functionary and falls in love with the photograph of James Bond or something to that effect, something silly like that. And of course, the British Secret Service, M, and James Bond, they think this is ridiculous that it's all set up. But as the book explains, they can't help themselves and they have to get involved. They don't know about the Robert Shaw character, Grant. So in the movie, he's not in it very much, and he's only about like fifth billing, though he's the master murderer. And in the book, he's not in it so much except for the chapters that explain his background. So you end up with all these machinations, and then you end up with these set pieces taking place in Turkey, which are very interesting for the most part. I don't think the gypsy camp and the fight between the two women for the leader's son was all that interesting. But that is in the book, and it doesn't play all that well on the screen, I find. I think it's really chunky and clunky. And then they have an ambush from, counter agents and all of that sort of stuff. But that's all in the book. And so Tehran Bey is the character, I think that's his name, and he becomes a friend of James Bond, and he's more or less running all of these things that are happening in Turkey, counter-espionage and all of this, and quite friendly toward the English, and seemed to have an agreement with most of the Russian agents that everybody knew when everybody was spying on each other and following each other in cars and things like this. So there's that whole thing going on there that really doesn't have anything to do with the essential plot, which is somebody's going to assassinate Bond to humiliate the Secret Service of all things. So that's all seems a bit odd, but anyway. So the girl, played by Daniela Bianchi, Tanya, so she's offering to bring over this device, decoding device. There's always some crummy decoding device that fits into a briefcase. It appears again in other Bond movies. They call it the Lecter here, but I think it was called the Spectre in the book. But I think it appeared, I don't remember which other movie, but I think it appeared again. And all of this is just a ruse to kill Bond in the most humiliating way possible. So, for the most part, like I say, there's a symmetry with the book. But when you watch the movie, they haven't figured out the Bond mythos yet. So it doesn't have the feeling that seemed to be fully established in the third movie, which is Goldfinger. This is the second movie. So it's the most realistic of the movies, probably. But to me, it plays a lot like a Hitchcock movie, even for the use of a lot of back screen projection when they're in the boat and the canals of Venice. You know that they're just being projected in front of a green screen or a blue screen. You've got a lot of that sort of scene in it. And the actual action is clunky, I find, But like I say, this was only the second movie, and it was more realistic. It was more of a Cold War spy story than probably the rest of them in the series, which become more science fiction and fantasy and comedic. So I recommend this movie, but there are parts that just lay there like piss on a plate. Just nothing. An interesting tidbit, I watched quite a few of the extras on this disc, and there's several of them. Good interview, small interview from the Canadian Broadcasting Corporation, our national broadcaster in Canada, the CBC has with Ian Fleming, who died in 64, so I think this was filmed in 63. So that's interesting. And then there's a discussion where Ian Fleming is talking to Raymond Chandler, the author of the not the Sam Spade, the Philip Marlowe novels. So that was interesting. We had a lot of photographs because it was probably a radio talk. A lot of extras, quite interesting. But I saw on IMDb, Internet Movie Database, that Danielle Bianchi had such a thick accent. She was a Miss Rome, I believe, and a Miss World follow-up in 1960. So she was only probably 20 or 21 then when she made this. She had such a thick Italian accent that she was actually dubbed by another Italian actress. So they did a good dubbing job. When you think about it, a thick Italian accent dubbed by another Italian actress to play a Russian-speaking English, I think it's all very interesting when you think about it. It could give you a headache if you think about it too much. But she really doesn't have a big screen presence. She's very beautiful, but there doesn't seem to be a lot there happening behind the eyes and the hairdos. Anyway, I do recommend it. I do recommend the book. I think that you'd enjoy the parts explaining things from the about the Russian, the Soviet Union in the late 50s. I thought it was quite interesting. But the resolution in the movie is the same as in the book. All of a sudden, it's 5 minutes. There's a fight between Bond and Grant, and it's essentially over. Bond is still trying to get from wherever he is at that point. He's still, I don't know which state around Belgrade, I guess, Yugoslavia, still trying to get to a neutral state or, you know, closer to England. And in the book, there's a better explanation of why they're even on the Orient Express than there is in the movie. In the movie, it seemed like they just kind of had to run and get on it, as opposed to that was part of the plot to get Bond isolated for 4 nights so that he could be killed. Anyway, it's Michael from Red Chair Diaries, and I recommend both of them for their own reasons. And I will see you around the tube.